With the 21st pick in the 2020 NBA Draft, the Philadelphia 76ers select Tyrese Maxey from the University of...
How can you not be excited today? I said all week long that I have never been more excited for the Sixers going into a draft where they haven't had, like, even a lottery, like, not even a top five, top 10, top 50, not even a lottery pick. 21st overall, I had never been more excited for a draft and draft night itself than I was going into last night, simply because the Wizard himself, Daryl Morey, was going to make some things happen for the Philadelphia 76ers. And what do you know? Going into it, before the draft even starts, poof, Al Horford, gone. Deuces, see you later. $81 million, deuces, see you later. And Danny Green comes to town. All right, let's party. Let's see what you got there. And then you go at 21 there, take Tyrese Maxey, hello player out of Kentucky. I know, Bob, we know that the story really broke here like a week ago. Lynch leaks, boom, right there. Hey, get this guy Kentucky, like this guy Kentucky, Tyrese Maxey. Bada boom, bada bing. He's here now, ladies and gentlemen.
Me and Daryl Morey, basically the same guy.
I'm pretty
Except
sure.
Now he's way Eagles more successful.
Yeah, now if the Eagles will only hire you for wide receivers, would be okay.
Hey. Keep it simple, stupid.
Yeah.
It's a very simple process, and they executed it to perfection last night. And then they had another magic wand, and they just make the guy that they made the promise to, they don't get him at 21. They don't get him at 34. They get him, like, what, with their third second-round pick? How is that even? What is that? Huh? My brain is just ninja'd, basically.
Daryl promised.
He is. I don't want to overstate anything, but I'm pretty sure Daryl Morey is the single greatest front office executive in the history of Philadelphia. I don't want to overshoot, though. I don't want to overshoot. But here's the deal. Bringing in Seth Curry to this offense, having him come off the bench in this offense is going to be beautiful. And what did every single Sixer fan say going into this offseason? What was the most common thing said? What does this team need?
Shooters.
This team has got to need shooters. So you get, what, a 43% three-point shooter? You get a guy that can also drive a little bit for himself. You get a guy that Daryl Morey called last night, and we'll let you hear it himself. Arguably, greatest shooter in the NBA right now. His brother's pretty good. So that's Daryl Morey saying it, not me. But you go and you get Seth Curry. I think you have made some major upgrades to this team. You go and you get Danny Green. You go and you get some guys here maybe that have some upside to them. But you really went out, and you got yourself two guys that you know can shoot, a third guy that has some promise, has some upside. You hope he can do that in Ferguson. And then you look at what you have right now and see what you could develop right now in Ben Simmons and Joel Embiid. But when you look at the guys that they brought in the first night and the guys they exported more or less, I don't understand how you can't be excited about the future. This is exactly what we laid out even last week. You got to hit the reset button on some trades. And that's what a lot of GMs have done here over the last couple of years in Philadelphia. Howie Roseman did it with a lot of the Chip Kelly players here. Hit the reset button. Guy was able to move up in the draft by hitting that reset button. The name that always jumps to mind there is DeMarco Murray. Moving on from that, some of the contracts that he inherited from Paul Holmgren. We've looked at this across the board with some other teams. And then you also look at the 76ers and what they did last night with Daryl Morey. It's unreal that they were able to unload those. And think about this for a second. It didn't cost you anything. A soon-to-be 27 deviates the contract of Al Horford, and it opens up spacing on the basketball court. The Sixers, I think, got significantly better last night in this draft. Addition by subtraction in some cases, and addition by addition in others. For instance, Seth Curry. That's the move that I look at, and I go, instantly better. Now, Al Horford leaving also, I think, makes you instantly better because it opens up that spacing. I am impressed. Look, do I think they're the number one team in the Eastern Conference? No, there's still a lot of work to be done. Ain't the question. A lot of work was put in last night by the Sixers front office. We have certainly spent our time ripping them, taking them apart, and all that stuff. Last night, what they did, it's a night to actually applaud what they did. Bob Cooney, I am, color me impressed, my friend.
Yeah, they had a vision, right? So both Daryl Morey and Doc Rivers come out and say, look, if you know, Ben Simmons needs guards around him. He needs shooters around him. He needs creators around him. And they went and they did that. I mean, Maxey's going to be a nice backup for you. Danny Green, Seth Curry, Isiah Joe. To expect anything out of rookies isn't very smart.
Right.
But they went out and got guys that they can build and guys that they need and maybe backups that can help this team. And Mark, you hit it. You not only helped your shit. I'm an on the court guy. Like mm-hmm. the money and all that stuff. Like obviously that's things you have to look at and figure out and whatever it may be. But I'm an on the court guy. And on the court, these are terrific moves surrounding Ben Simmons. Off the court, though, as you stated, getting rid of all that money, opening yourself up to you're still in play to do bigger things if you'd like. Like you made yourself that yeah. good. And some people are alluding out there. Oh. Well, what they did with money, they could. That door's still open, yes. I believe it is. But with the way they surrounded Ben Simmons with guys that they exactly, without saying names before the draft, with guys that they exactly said would make Ben Simmons better, the type of players, by getting them, I think the future, and by Daryl Morey saying late last night, that Ben Simmons and Joel Embiid are going to be here for a long yeah. time. I don't think he's BSing. Yeah. I really think they're building around those two guys.
You got to hear him talk about the potential. Like, this cut got me really excited. when he talks about Ben and Joe surrounded by shooters, it's hard not to be excited.
Like, yeah. how great they have been. And who he's alluding to, I believe, is he's alluding to J.J. Redick.
Sure.
He's alluding yeah. to even a little bit of, like, Marco Bellinelli to a point,
yeah,
too.
Maybe,
like, anybody that could shoot.
Maybe
like,
a little Cove thrown in, a little spice of Cove.
Right.
But, yeah, it's exciting.
I can't. I went in with, I'm not gonna lie, I went in with some great expectations because I think most people would say, oh, they're not gonna move Horford. It's gonna be a tough contract to move. Who would want him? The whole thing, and then just like that, he waved his Daryl Morey magic wizard wand, and all of a sudden he was gone, just like that. And you brought in shooting, and you you alleviated so much cap over the next couple of years in moving on from Al Horford. My expectations have been exceeded. The only thing is that you wanted them to add Tyrese Maxey's numbers, especially from 3-point range, 29%. Not impressive. Although our guest at 9 o'clock today, Amy Fadul, who by the way is our local Kentucky basketball ambassador. She knows more about Kentucky basketball than anyone I've ever met in my life. She is going to break down everything Tyrese Maxey does on the court and how his job wasn't really going after 3-point shots in that Kentucky offense. So we'll get the explanation from Amy Fadul of NBC Sports Philadelphia and host. We'll get it from her. 8 o'clock today, we'll still talk some Eagles football. We got Dan Orlovsky joining us as he does every Thursday at 8 o'clock. I had a text message conversation with Dan last night. I just asked him, I said, hey, man, I'm not going to make a habit of this, but I know I'm going to ask you about this specific play. And it was the 3rd and 3 play that Carson Wentz threw the incompletion to, the pick play to Jalen yeah. Reagor. I won't read his explanation. I'll let him describe it himself. But we got some football conversation for you. So that's at 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock, Amy Fadul. 9:30 today, MLS Coach of the Year Jim Curtin will join the program. Also, huge Sixers fan. I want to see if he's excited as well. So we'll talk to him about that. 9:40, Tyrese Maxey himself. Very emotional last night, Bob. I don't know if you...
The whole first round was.
I said this to Mark earlier this morning, James.
Oh, my God.
It seemed to me like it was a yawn. You know how you see somebody yawn and you can't help but yawn?
Yeah.
It's like when the first pick's taken and he cries, everybody just started crying.
It's like...
I've never seen anything like it.
Or ESPN's just diabolical.
Hey, all right, guys.
Congratulations on the greatest achievement of your life. What's the worst thing that's ever happened to your family? Go.
I'm not a conspiracy theorist.
It seems like they're pulling some strings.
But ESPN totally had every pick right before they were on TV rub their eyes with onions. I'm just telling you right now.
We'll put out Malika Andrews, who looked lovely last night, and we'll ask you, what's the saddest thing that's ever happened to your family? Go ahead.
Look, Malika Andrews was going like full like Barbara Walters special tone.
Yeah, I think Tom Rinaldi produced last night's draft or something.
I swear I was waiting for him to pop out in the background. If Malika like struggled a little bit, here comes Tom Rinaldi.
Mr. Mormona journalist I've ever seen.
And this night, how does it make you feel? remember when your father remember when your father passed away? How'd that make you feel? We ain't making fun of him. We're making fun of ESPN. It's the greatest. It really is. It's the greatest night of their life. But you are teeing up. Like, we don't see that at a normal NBA draft.
Mike Mulhern, who works down at NBC Sports Philly, tweeted me back, and he said, I think them being in their homes, surrounded by family, kind of made it a little more tier-worthy.
And I'll say this. ESPN did a phenomenal job. We praise the NFL for everything they did during their draft. They did a great job with it. ESPN did a wonderful job. Adam Silver, phenomenal job with this draft. And I think that's exactly, I didn't see Mike say that, but I had the same thought. Usually we see them get up in an arena. Usually people are applauding, hopefully. And they hug their dad, they hug their mom, high five their agent, whatever it might be, hug their college coach, John Calipari pants bounces around from table to table. And they go up to the stage, they shake the commissioner's hand, take the picture, everything's cool. Being at home or surrounded by their loved ones, like it wasn't just like one or two people from their family, it was everybody. So amazingly emotional, and it was wild to watch, and it was just so... Just talking to Malika Andrews with her tone, the way she was delivering the questions was just so somber. It was beautiful.
Yeah.
It almost made me cry, to be honest with you.
She's only 25 years old. You brought that up this morning.
She had a stint at Chicago Tribune, I believe the New York Times. She's got a lot of background to her. God bless her.
Yeah.
And she is phenomenal at her job. And I just will throw this in as well.
She looked pretty too, Mark.
We are just overall impressed with everything that the Sixers did last night. And the one thing I was going to say this, not disappointed in, but it was like it was going so well. Why can't they do this? I was waiting for them to trade up. I was waiting for them to trade. The one, everything else, I am just tickled pink and impressed with everything that they pulled off last night.
Yeah, and you know, reading a lot of national people about the Sixers pick and Tyrese Maxey, he's a guy that could have gone in the you know, lottery. He's a guy that could have gone early, of a guy that can create, a guy that's... my favorite part about him being picked was what John Calipari said. Yeah, it made me think of Jamie right away. He's one of those Kentucky guys that just has it.
Yeah.
You know, and Jamie's been calling for it. You know, those Kentucky guards, they're just something different about them. And I go back to covering a Final 4 years ago when John Calipari said, look, consider me a professor at the college. You give me your kid and I'll make you the promise that after I'm done teaching him, he's going to go make millions in his career. Isn't that okay that I have a kid for 1 year and I let him go?
Yes.
Yeah, well,
hard to argue.
That's the thing with Kentucky kids. Their college numbers usually suffer because they're surrounded by six or seven other McDonald's All-Americans, and they do a good job of sharing the rock plate to better pros because of that, because their college numbers suffer. So they slip a little bit. If Tyrese Maxey played in a March Madness on a national stage, he's one of those guys that would have carried a team to a Sweet 16 or an Elite Eight run, and he would have been a lottery pick. The Sixers may have benefited from the canceled college basketball season. I really believe that.
All right, so let me ask you this then, because I know you've been high on this guy, and we'll ask Amy the same question, and we'll kick it around with all our callers today. Why only 29% from three?
I'm not too concerned about it. He shot 40% from three in five games versus top 25 teams. And one of the things you look at, he wasn't asked to shoot it a ton.
Right.
So
but still.
It's a low number. So it's
small
whatever.
Sample size.
Free throw percentage. He's like an 83, 84. That's usually a good thing to look at when you're trying to figure out if a shot can translate at the next level. So I think it's there. I think his form will be fine. I just think he wasn't asked to do it a ton, and I think he's a gamer.
And if this roster stays the way it is right now, with a Seth Curry, with a Danny Green, you know, you still have Korkmaz. You have capable shooters. I'm looking at this kid more as a creator, as more of a guy that, you know, a dribble penetrator.
Oh, yeah.
You know, one of the guys, because that's one of, we talk about shooters all the time, correctly so, but one of the other things that the Sixers were lacking was just guys that could create for themselves.
Handle the ball.
And when you say create for yourself, I don't mean just a guy that can beat a guy off the dribble and score, but creating for yourself means getting yourself in a position, to me, where you have the opportunity to either score or kick or whatever. You're creating baskets. It doesn't mean just for yourself. This kid is a creator. From all the stuff that I've watched on him, that's where I look at him. The three-point, I'm with you. I don't really care about the three-point shooting with him particularly.
Okay. My only thing is that seems to be more and more the way the NBA...
Oh, yeah. No, I hear you.
Yeah.
I totally hear you.
And we've talked about it. NBA are in three-point attempts, and they're not. That's under Brett Brown, obviously, so now it's a different coaching regime. But people act like, oh, look, they shoot way too many. No, they didn't shoot that much, and they weren't that good at it to begin with. But now, if you really want to go the rest of the way that the NBA is going, you got to make sure that you're packing your roster with shooters. Seth Curry, hey, great start to that. Hey, bringing in Isiah Joe, hopefully he develops into an NBA talent.
Yeah.
Right? He's definitely, one thing I'll say about him, because we talked about his great shooting form and all that, one thing he's got to do is get stronger with the basketball. Like, he's way too weak with the basketball.
I'll tell you what, the more and more, and after they got him last night, I watched some more stuff of him. I'm telling you, man, he reminds me, I said this yesterday, he reminds me almost exactly of Robert Covington. When the Sixers got Covington, we were down in San Antonio. He came into the gym. He started shooting, started playing. And Brown comes over. He's like, what do you see? And I'm like, this kid's an NBA shooter, something. And at that time, the Sixers were winning, like, you know, 10 games or whatever.
Right.
And I was just like, this kid is an NBA shooter. I watched this kid, Isiah Joe. I see some of the same stuff. And it was the same exact things they were saying about Covington. NBA shooter, he's got to get better defensively, but he has the body to do it. This kid, he reminds me, even his movements on the floor, his kind of allergicness of the lane is similar to Robert Covington. I, for all you processors out there,
but
there you go.
Most important, can he make a layup?
Yeah, I did see him make one in the highlight yesterday. I thought of that, too.
Because Covington couldn't.
Will he ever say one of the dumbest quotes ever in the history of Philadelphia sports? Robert Covington, I'm not struggling. My shot's just not falling.
Great quote.
Oh, my God. It's poetry. It's just pure poetry. It's a beautiful thing. So we got so much to get into. So here's my question today. And this seemed to be the only great divide on social media last night among Sixers fans. The only great divide, and it has nothing to do with Anna Horford, who we'll get to a little bit later. The only great divide is how much better did they get last night? Are they better than the Celtics right now? Are they better than
Celtics
the
Celtics had a really good draft.
They got the guy that I wanted. Now we were all texting about it last night. They
got the guy that I wanted.
They did. They got
right.
Paid.
Yeah, right? That's right.
And he went later than I.
Yeah,
ever
I think last pick of the first. Yeah,
yeah, yeah. Yeah. And so the Celtics got better as well last night. How much did the Sixers get better last night? Because I do think that they got better. I am going to have cautious optimism about what they have right now. Is Danny Green your starting shooting guard right now on this squad? Because what do you do right now?
Maybe Shake. We'll see what Doc has in mind.
Right.
I mean, Seth is capable of it.
He's not a star. I mean, he hasn't started a lot.
I mean, the starter role title is, you know.
I just look at minutes. Like, Curry went almost 24-25 last year. Here's the thing I'll take away real quick, Mark,
and
from last
free
night.
Agency stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah, sure.
Didn't that seem awfully easy for Daryl Morey to just do what he did? Like,
yes.
All right, this is a wrong here. Let me write it.
Yes.
And I equate that to, I think it's going to happen on the floor, too. I think you're going to watch about 10 games and say, whoa. Oh, my God. Look at Ben Simmons. Look at Joel Embiid. Wow. Yeah. This really is kind of easy.
Yeah, let me see spacing. That's what
I really do. I just think, like, this organization, you have some really good pieces, was just such in a knot and all tied up. And Daryl Morey came in and goes, oh, wait, hold on. Just pull this string, that string, the other. And now it's getting flatter. And then Doc Rivers, I think, is going to come in with the iron and just straighten it all out. And I think this is going to be a real special season. We talked about it before, and it's starting to happen.
I hope so. I'm tempering my expectations right now. I'm just I'm not going to go crazy. I am very much in favor of every move they made last night. I think it's a beautiful thing and all that. I'm excited for that. I'm excited yourself from with the Al Horford deal. I'm excited for all of it, and I am very excited about Doc Rivers, because ultimately, that to me is going to be the biggest difference. If you want to look at last night and be negative about it somehow magically and say, oh, well, did they get any better? They didn't get any better last night. Well, first off, wrong. They absolutely got better last night. And the main thing is going to be how Doc Rivers coaches this team. That's the X factor in all this. You could talk about adding talent. You could talk about moving on from money and moving money around to another team and all that. But what you really have to focus on is how this talent right now is going to be organized and the spacing that you're going to have to try to establish in your offense. The positionless basketball, whatever you want to call it with Doc Rivers, as we've heard from other NBA coaches throughout, fine. But really what I want to see is how Doc Rivers coaches these guys up. And unfortunately, that's what we're going to have to wait at least, another month at least to see how it all kind of comes together.
That's how quick it's back. But the big question here is, Mark, could you work for your father-in-law? That's the big question. Seth Curry's going to be working for his father-in-law.
Frank, you're in.
Yeah.
Let's see you perform, Mark.
I could work for my father-in-law because my father-in-law would be like, take a 2-hour lunch for just drink beer. Like that would be my father-in-law's like work at like, oh, Mark, just let's have a couple of beers and discuss this. So I could do that. NBA level, I don't know about that. Plus, I've seen my father-in-law attempt a jump shot. It didn't go well. No. But I can't get over a draft where they had the 21st overall pick. I am this giddy the next day because of all the other moves that were made throughout. So how much better did the Sixers get last night? Just last night alone, how much better did they get? What was your reaction to being able to move on from Al Horford, bringing in Danny Green, bringing in Seth Curry as well, and then two picks that I think are going to work out pretty well here in Philadelphia in Tyrese Maxey and also Isiah Joe. We'll get to some of the other picks that were made last night. We'll get to some other things that were happening throughout the NBA draft. Other moves and everything. We got plenty of Eagles conversation as well. Like I said, 8 o'clock today, Dan Orlovsky will join the show. 9 o'clock, Amy Fadul. 9:30, Jim Curtin. 9:40, Tyrese Maxey himself will be on the show. Look forward to that. When we come back, we'll let you hear a little bit from Maxey and Maury on last night's transactions. So excited. 610-632-0975. And also, by the way, personal announcement. I'm in studio, folks.
Yeah, we all are. It's here, gonna be back.
Here I am.
We just need a montage.
We need a montage.
I have a reverse montage.
Mark Farzetta with Bob Cooney and Jamie Lynch. Mornings on 97.5 The Fanatic. Philadelphia.